So we are going to discuss the life of Srivasa Thakura, also called as Srivasa Pandita today. And we'll have the discussion on Advaita Acharya, Nityananda Prabhu and Gadadhara Pandit in the next coming Sundays. This will all build up to Kaur Purnima, which is going to be celebrated next month. And we'll have other Vaishnavas speak on that occasion. But for these four Sundays, we will hear about these four personalities. Srivasa Pandita is one of the less known, less discussed personalities among the Pancha-tattva. We hear often about the life of Nityananda Prabhu, and we also hear about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and then about Advaita Acharya. But the life of Gadadhara Pandit and Srivasa Thakura are seldom discussed. So it's good to start with them, especially Srivasa Thakura. He has been mentioned by all the Gaudiya literatures, especially the Chaitanya literatures. The first generation biographies of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, namely Chaitanya Charitamrita, Chaitanya Bhagavata and Chaitanya Mangal. For those of us who are not aware of these terms or these words, Chaitanya Charitamrita is one of the most bona fide authorized works on the life of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and has been composed by a very great personality called Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami. Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami was about 97 years old when he composed Chaitanya Charitamrita, or compiled and offered Chaitanya Charitamrita. And it's fascinating how he was elected by the Vaishnava community to write this text. He considered himself to be utterly unqualified. From the material perspective, he couldn't see because of his advanced age. Almost he had lost the power to even open and close his eyelids on his own accord. So he had to keep it open, and then he would drop and the eyelids would drop. He had lost the power to hear. His hands were trembling. His body was very weak. He had a hunched back, and it was materially impossible to compile such an exalted, celebrated work. So he had access to some of the confidential diaries that were carried by the personal servants of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. There's a very exalted work, which is the diary of Murari Gupta, and he had an access to it. So he could compile from there some of the pastimes of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And at the same time, he said that, what is my qualification? My only qualification is that I have access to the classes given by Raghunath Das Goswami. In our previous seminar, we mentioned how Rupa Goswami and Sanatan Goswami were personally empowered by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told Rupa and Sanatan that, I cannot go to Vrindavan, but I want you both to go to Vrindavan, and I will work through your bodies. So during that time, Srila Raghunath Das Goswami happened to come to Vrindavan and settle down in Radhakund, very specifically after the departure of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And there he would give three hours of classes every evening on his personal interactions with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. It was Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami who was found in this assembly by the Vaishnava Acharyas. He would sit there every evening and take notes from the classes of Raghunath Das Goswami. And Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami had already published a book in the Vaishnava circle called as Govinda Leelamrita before Chaitanya Charitamrita, and because of which he was also given the title Kaviraj. The word Kavi means a poet and Raj means the king. So he was given this title of being the king among poets or authors because of his work, Govinda Leelamrita. Therefore, the Vaishnava community came to him and said, you are very advanced, not just in age, but even in spiritual realization. You have access to the diaries of the servants of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. You have heard every evening from Raghunath Das Goswami. And at the same time, you just compiled Govinda Leelamrita. So you're very qualified. Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, in his utter humility, said, I really don't think I should write this work. But if all of you desire that I should do it, I will do it. But I will do it after taking blessings of Srila Sanatan Goswami's Madan Mohan deity. So he came in front of Radha Madan Mohan and he was praying. And Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, in his utter humility, asked the deity, "Do you really think I should do this?" And a garland fell from the neck of Madan Mohan. So the pujari got the garland and put around the neck of Kaviraj Goswami and said, "The Lord has answered your prayer and he wants you to write this book." Kaviraj Goswami thought this was a coincidence. So he accepted the garland and he continued praying. Radha Madan Mohan came in the dream of Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami and said, "Do not fear. Just come to me. I will speak this work and you simply write. I will give you all the details. I will also empower you with strength. So I will speak to you and I will write through you. You simply take the credit." So this is a very beautiful point, that when someone is spiritually enlightened and spiritually capable, he becomes empowered and Krishna personally does things through him. Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he spread the message of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as far as Canada, being in Navadvip. He sent his book, Teachings of Lord Chaitanya, the life and precepts, the principles of Gauranga's teachings. He sent this book to one of the very prestigious universities and libraries in Canada. It's still found there. But however, he didn't travel and do it personally. When Srila Prabhupada was asked this, "Why didn't Bhaktivinoda Thakur do this personally?" Srila Prabhupada said, "So that he can give me the credit." So this is indeed a very beautiful point, that Krishna takes joy in giving credit to his pure devotees. He does the work, but he gives credit to his pure devotees. Just like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has predicted that the holy name will spread in every town and village. So we may go out and we may preach, we may do Sankirtan, we may do the book distribution, and devotees are being made. Interestingly, it is not we who are doing it, because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has already predicted that the message will spread. So it is spreading by his proclamation, and we participate in his proclamation and partake in the credit. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is doing it, and very lovingly he is giving credit to those who are participating in this mission. Just like we find even in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna told Arjuna, "I have already killed everyone in the opposite party. You simply have to do the service of dropping the bodies down. You have to shoot the arrows and drop the Kaurava bodies down. I have already killed them. So I have done the killing, but you take the credit." So Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami was empowered by Radha Madan Mohan himself, who dictated and also wrote through him, and this beautiful literature of Chaitanya Charitamrita was given to this world. So Chaitanya Charitamrita mentions the glories of Srivasa Thakur. Also during that time, there were other biographers who had written biographies about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, namely Vrindavan Das Thakur's Chaitanya Bhagavat and Lochan Das Thakur's Chaitanya Mangal. So they are considered to be the first generation among Chaitanya literatures. Then came the second generation literatures describing Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his associates. First generation and second generation associates. What are some books in that generation? Bhakti Ratnakar of Narahari Chakravarti, Prem Vilas, Narottam Vilas. These are some books which were in the second generation, written after. And they also describe associates later and at the same time associates of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in the first generation like Srivasa Thakur. So the reason I'm mentioning all this is so that first of all we understand where all of this information is coming from. Very specifically in a book called Prem Vilas, if you can find it, that mentions many pastimes about Srivasa Thakur. And of course Chaitanya Charitamrita does. So let's begin. Chaitanya Charitamrita mentions this very beautiful verse, which you can kindly mention and repeat. Pancha-tattva eka vastu,
konu nahi
bhed, lila rasa aswadite, vivida vibhed. What does this mean? Pancha-tattva eka vastu. These five personalities, namely Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Nityananda Prabhu, Advaita Acharya, Gadadhar Pandit and Srivasa Thakur, they are called Pancha-tattva. they are the Supreme Lord Shri Krishna appearing in five different forms. Konu nahi bhed. There is no difference between them. As it is described, Radha and Krishna are two, but they appeared in one form as Gauranga in Kali Yuga. And that one split into five so that it is easier to spread devotion. When you have to spread devotion, you need more hands. Although Krishna has innumerable hands, he's appearing in five forms to make the work easier. So Pancha-tattva eka vastu, they are actually the same being Krishna, konu nahi bhed, there is no difference. Then why are they appearing in five forms? Lila rasa aswadite vivida vibhed. They are coming in different forms only to heighten devotional interactions. So Krishna is coming as Chaitanya. Balaram is coming as Nityananda. Please don't mistake this to be Nityananda Swami. This is Lord Nityananda. We are not promoting any godmen. We are talking on the basis of scriptural evidence. Because nowadays, if you just say Nityananda, by default they think you're talking about Swami Nityananda. But we are talking about Lord Nityananda, who appeared 500 years ago. So Chaitanya is none different from Radha and Krishna. Nityananda Prabhu is the incarnation of Balaram. Lord Vishnu appeared as Advaita Acharya. Also, he is called as Sadashiva. Radharani separately appeared as Gadadhar Pandit. And the personality under discussion today, Srivas Pandit, is none other than Narada Muni. Narada Muni appeared in Kali Yuga as Srivas Thakur. Where is this information found? It is found in a book called Gaura Ganodesh Deepika by Kavi Karnapur, which matches and has a very good tabular presentation of who were the different members of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's pastime and what is their actual eternal identity. Are they mere mortals or are they eternal associates? So let's begin. It's described that Srivas Thakur appeared in a village called Sri Hatta to a very wonderful Vaishnav by the name Haladhara Pandit. Haladhara Pandit had five sons, namely, please repeat, Nalini, Srivas Thakur, Sri Ram Thakur, Sri Pati Thakur, and Sri Nidhi Thakur. Of this, the last four, or let's say second, third, fourth, and fifth, Srivas, Sri Ram, Shri Pati and Shri Nidhi. Let's repeat. Srivas, Shri Ram, Shri Pati, Shri Nidhi. So these four brothers are more prominent and their roles are very wonderfully described and what their services are described. So we said Srivas Pandit is an incarnation of Narada Muni. His brother Shri Ram Pandit is an incarnation of Parvata Muni. And Parvata Muni is Narada Muni's best friend. So both friends appeared as brothers. So if you want more information about who this Parvata Muni is, you may have heard about the story of the deliverance of Mrigari, the hunter. And interestingly, initially it is Narada Muni who intervenes and tells Mrigari that why do you half-kill these animals. Now, why do you attack them half-kill? You don't kill them completely and you don't let them go. You have the sadistic pleasure of seeing them suffer. Why do you do this? So there's no need for you to do this. You don't have to do this killing for your family. Just worship Sri Hari and he will maintain you. And Mrigari gives up all his sin and starts chanting the holy name. And all the villagers from neighborhood, they start getting grains and fruits and vegetables, and they maintain Mrigari. Later, when Narada Muni comes along with Parvata Muni, they see this amazing transformation in the life of Mrigari. He's no longer a hunter, but he's a sage who's jumping and hopping from one place to another. Parvata Muni asks Mrigari, why are you doing this? So Mrigari says, there are so many ants on the floor. If I start walking straight, I may end up stamping and killing them. So I am jumping and hipping and hopping so that I don't kill and land on any of these ants. So Parvata Muni looks at Narad Muni and he says, all glories to your preaching. You have transformed a hunter into a great saint. So that is Parvata Muni there. So there are many stories like that. So Parvata Muni appeared as Sri Ram Pandit, Srivas Pandit's brother. Now, although appeared in Sri Hatta, they moved very quickly to a place called Kumara Hatta. And from Kumara Hatta, they moved to Navadvip. Navadvip is the birthplace of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And from Navadvip, Shantipur is not that far away. Shantipur is the place where Advaita Acharya lived, about whom we are going to talk next week. So now, as Srivas Thakur or Srivas Pandit moved from Sri Hatta to Kumara Hatta, Kumara Hatta to Navadvip, Navadvip is close to Shantipur. Srivas Thakur spent a lot of time with Advaita Acharya. And they had many things in common. First and foremost, both of them were very senior in age as compared to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. It is described Advaita Acharya was about 60 years old when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared. And Mahaprabhu had his pastimes for 48 years. And Advaita Acharya lived 40 years after the departure of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So 60 plus 48 in another 40. So he lived about 140 or 150 years. So Advaita Acharya was one of those empowered living beings who was sent as a buffer before the appearance, during the pastimes, and to take care after the departure. So he was one of those roles, which we'll discuss next week. So Srivas Thakur was also pretty advanced in age. They were together, Advaita Acharya and Srivas. So this was one commonality. The second commonality is that Advaita Acharya is Vishnu. And Srivas Thakur is Narada Muni. And we all know the relation of Narayana with Narada Muni. They are together. They're always associated in devotion. So when they appeared, even in this pastime, they were best among associates. The third commonality is that Advaita Acharya and Srivas Thakur, both of them were bleeding in compassion because Kali Yuga was deteriorating rampantly, especially in Navadvip. What was the sign of deteriorating Kali Yuga in Navadvip? When scriptural knowledge is used for any other purpose except devotion, it is an attack of Kali. When you read Shastras and it doesn't lead you to the process of actually devoting yourself to Krishna, then that is an attack of Kali Yuga. When we use scriptural knowledge to show off how many verses we know, how many stories we know, how many songs we know, or we use that scriptural knowledge to have a vision of just seeing faults in others. Like Srila Prabhupada, one devotee was mentioning, forbid his disciples from reading Hari Bhakti Vilas. Because Hari Bhakti Vilas has a list of do's and don'ts. And Prabhupada said, there are so many do's and don'ts. If you memorize all of that, you will simply have fault-finding mentality as to who's doing it and who's not doing it. Prabhupada said, these literatures must be read with maturity. But if I give it to you right now, you will just spoil the society with fault-finding. So therefore, if scriptures are used just to find faults in others, or scriptures are used to show I know more than you, or if scriptures are used to debate and argue on pitiless, pointless, insignificant issues, then that is an attack of Kali. Krishna says, Sarvasya chaham ridhisanni vishto matta smriti jnanam apohanam cha. Everyone else must also chant. This is from Bhagavad Gita. It's a very simple verse. So Krishna is saying, of all the Vedas, I am to be known. So if we are reading the scriptures and if we don't find Sri Hari, then we have wasted our time. But if someone chants Hari, even if they have not read the four Vedas, they have got to the essence of the four Vedas. Kwachaham kitava papam brahmagno nirapatrapa kwacha narayana ityetad bhagavan nama mangalam. Ajamil, the Brahmana described in the sixth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, He says, Kvachaham, who am I? Kvacha aham, kitavaha papam, I am fallen and sinful. And Brahmagno, I have been a blot in the line of Brahmanas. And Nirapatrapa, I am still shameless. But Kvacha Narayana iti etad, Bhagavan Nama Mangalam. The only good quality I had is that I called upon the four syllables, Na, Ra, Ya, Na, and Bhagavan Nama Mangalam. This name is all auspicious. So therefore we find in the life of Ajamil, there were four Vishnudutas who appeared. Correct? Three Yamadutas appeared and four Vishnudutas appeared. Next time you see the painting, you can count. Three Yamadutas and four Vishnudutas. Three Yamadutas because they had a list of all the sins he had committed through thought, word and deed. Karmana manasa vacha. Ajamil was sinning through his mind, through his words and through his activities. And Yamadutas, one Yamaduta couldn't hold all of that information. So they got three of them and they were holding that information. And there are four Vishnudutas because na, ra, ya, na. The four syllables manifested as four associates of the Lord. And these four syllables are the essence of the four Vedas. So if you have a lot of data in your head, but if that is not leading you to chanting the holy names of Krishna, then somewhere you're wasting your time. Because all that information will be finished as the body is gone. But the devotion that can be done with that knowledge is eternal. So this is another commonality. Srivas Thakur and Advaita Acharya were both burning in compassion looking at the situation in Navadvip. Srivas Thakur was also close friends with Jagannath Mishra, the father of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. It is described that Srivas Thakur used to be called as the shadow of Jagannath Mishra. Wherever Jagannath Mishra would move, Srivas Thakur would come. And Srivas Thakur's wife, Malini, was actually physically helping Shachi Mata during childbirth of Nimai. So during that time, they used to have a separate room in the house, which was called as Prasuti Graha. That is the place where women would give birth, you know, because it's not an easy task. So they have a separate room for themselves. Nowadays, you have like a hospital, you have somewhere outside, you know. During those times, they would have it inside, but they would have toilets outside. Now we have this outside and toilets inside. In Vedic culture, the farther the toilet is from the house, the more civilized you are. It used to be like that. Like if you have a house very close to the toilet, it's considered to be poverty-stricken time. But if your house is like 2 kilometers away from the toilet, you're very rich. That you can afford a house farther away from the toilet. Then, you know, it started coming closer and closer, and now every room has an attached toilet and bathroom, and then that's considered to be posh. It's almost abominable that you have a house of Sri Hari and you pass stool and urine in the same house. In Vedic culture, it's considered to be abominable. But they would have childbirth in the same house. So Malini, the wife of Srivas Thakur, personally helped in the appearance of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And then it's described that just like Narada Muni instigated the quick appearance of Krishna, you see, when Kamsa Maharaj let go Vasudev got his first child and Kamsa Maharaj said, no problem, you take him back. No problem, you know, I trust you. And it was Narada Muni who came and he said, you trust whom? Who is the first and who is the eighth? And you know the flip that we discussed last seminar. So it was Narada Muni who instigated in the quick speeding up of the appearance of Sri Krishna. Similarly, it was Narada Muni in the form of Srivas Thakur who along with Advaita Acharya called out loudly and kind of instigated to speed up the appearance of Sri Krishna Chaitanya. So they did that same pastime twice, Narada Muni for Krishna and Srivas Thakur for Gauranga. And Chaitanya Charitamrita describes Srivas Thakur was also playing the role of an uncle. So the culture then was the parents would never chastise the children. Never. They would have uncle and aunt who would do it. So in that way, even if the children have some hard feelings, it's towards the uncle and not towards their parents. So this was Vedic culture. parents, if they were disappointed with something, they would tell the uncle. Jagannath Mishra would tell Srivasa Thakur that, you know, I'm fed up with this Nimai. But if he tells Nimai, Nimai would hold it against the father. So even if the father says good things, Nimai will not take it up because of that grudge. So there used to be an uncle who would play this villain role. And the children may or may not have this hard feelings towards the uncle, but the uncle would work on the dictation of the father. So the father has his message given, but the uncle is the villain. So it was kind of an interesting setup. And one person's father is another person's uncle. So the whole community was taken care of like that. You see, so that's interesting. When you have a Vaishnav community, that's another thing in parenting you can do. Anything you have to say, find an uncle. find someone whom your children, well, now kids are there in this class, so it doesn't work. But this was kind of interesting, that Jagannath Mishra would always embrace and always try to love Nimai. And whatever grievance he had, he would tell Srivas to chastise. So like, for example, it is described when Nimai Pandit, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu used to be called Nimai as a child because he appeared under a neem tree. He was very irregular to school. Kids, you shouldn't hear this class. Just put your fingers into it. Yeah, okay, good. So, no, that's fine. You can take it. I'm joking. So Nimai would skip school many times. He would say, I'm going to school. He would tell his parents, I'm going to school. Mohit, good, you should not listen. You can take it. You're good kids. You can take your hand. So he would not go to school, Nimai. And what he would do is he would go on the banks of the Ganga and, you know, kind of bully the sadhus. They would be chanting their Gayatri and Nimai would drink some Ganga water and spit on their face. And he would kind of push them into the water as they're chanting Gayatri and their counting is gone. Again, they have to start. Or sometimes they would go in the middle of the water so that they cannot be pushed. And they would stand and they would chant Gayatri. And Nimai would swim and go underwater and tickle their feet and pull their dhoti. Now they cannot come out. Or pull them, you know, push them. And he would do so many things. They would have matted hair and he would try to open it up and jump on top. And they would go and complain to Jagannath Mishra. And here the teachers would complain that Nimai hasn't come. And Nimai, what he would do? He would take some ink and put it on over his dress. And with a bag, he would try walking towards home to show how much he has studied that day, that all the ink has touched his uniform. And he would come home and he would tell his father, the teachers are all lying. You think this ink will come just like that? And he would say so sweetly that Nanda Maharaj, in the form of Jagannath Mishra's heart, would completely be melted. Because he's after all Gopal. Adharam madhuram vadanam madhuram nayanam madhuram hasitam madhuram hridayam madhuram gamanam madhuram madhuradhipate rakilam madhuram madhuradhipate rakilam madhuram. So he would say it so sweetly that Jagannath Mishra will agree. Next day again, same story. He would go on the banks of the Ganga and young girls are worshipping Lord Shiva. And Nimai would go and sit there. And they are taking all the coconuts and they're taking all the paraphernalia for worship of Lord Shiva so that they get a good husband. And Nimai would sit there and tell all the girls, so you want a good husband? Then why are you worshipping Shiva? You worship my lotus feet. Even Shiva worships my lotus feet. They said, hey, what are you saying? This is not correct. You should worship Lord Shiva. He said, I don't have to worship Lord Shiva. You not read Brahma Samhita, Kshiram Yatha Dadi Vikara Vishesha Yoga? He's my transformation after all. And he's my servant. His wife is also my servant. His children are also my servant. It's Lord Shiva after all who has Advaita Acharya called the Supreme Lord. So Nimai can say all this. Girl said, we don't want to listen to you. Forget about worshipping you. We don't even want to see your face. You're an offender. Vaishnava Paradi. Nimai said, okay. Then you take my blessings. My blessings is that you will have old husbands who are all very diseased, and you will be a wife with 10 other co-wives to the same husband. You don't want to worship me? This is my blessings. I'm a Brahmana. I'm son of Jagannath Mishra and Nilambar Chakravarti, an astrologer and a powerful Brahmana is my maternal grandfather. So I'm very powerful. You take my blessings. And they would run. Don't know what to do. We can't worship him because he's an offender, and can't ignore him because he curses. So they would all go and complain to Jagannath Mishra. And Jagannath Mishra would say, I'm fed up with this child. Every day newer complaints. And he would take all these complaints to Srivasa Thakura. So Srivasa Thakura or Srivasa Pandit was the bad uncle who had to deal with all these tantrums. Jagannath Mishra would see Nima and say, you're such a nice boy. So obedient. So submissive. And would go and tell Srivasa, can you, you know, do something? Srivasa said, okay, don't worry. I will take care. And he would try talking to Nima, and then Nima would trick him and run. So Srivasa Thakura got a lot of special service to get the affection of Nimai. Now as Nimai started growing up, he took on the scholastic approach of being an argumentative scholar. So all the older Vaishnavas would try to avoid him, because if they come close to him, he would waste their time. They would be on their way to go to the temple to chant the holy name or attend some class or kirtan. And Nimai would come in the way and talk about grammar and nyaya. And then they would, young little boy, so they cannot ignore him. So they would try speaking to him, and he would take that discussion 45, 50 minutes into an argument and debate. So next time they would see Nimai coming, they would say, let's save our time and, you know, walk from another lane. And people of the same age surrendered to him because they couldn't stand his argument. So Srivasa Thakura, as Nimai was growing up, he avoided him. But one day, he caught hold of him. And this is the first pastime for the day. I'm going to tell you five pastimes of Srivasa with five lessons that we can take home. Because Srivasa Thakura's life is so voluminous, we can't cover all of that today. But five pastimes with five lessons that take home that we can have. So the first pastime here is that when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu became so scholastic and he wasn't displaying devotional sentiments of chanting or hearing and things like that, he was just stuck with grammar and logic and nyaya and pravinya and navinya and all of these different streams of nyaya. So Srivasa Thakura got hold of Nimai one day, and Nimai was with 4 to 5 other classmates. Class goes till 1 o'clock, correct? 12:45? Oh, really? 1. Oh, okay, because I thought now, did I just miss time? Oh, okay. I thought I missed time, then I said it was maybe 12:30, because Vaman Hari Prabhu cannot be wrong on time. Okay, all right, fair enough. Because even on the board, I saw 11:30 to 1, so I was just planning my class accordingly, if that's okay. Okay. So, he caught hold of Nimai, and Nimai was not alone this time. Because if he catches hold of Nimai alone, then Nimai will whip him with logic and grammar. So today, he caught him with 4 or 5 other boys, so Nimai will behave. He said, Nimai, I have something to talk to you. Nimai said, what is it about? Srivasa Thakura said, what is the use of all this knowledge? You are the crest jewel among the students of mundane materialistic knowledge. You are studying all this Shastra, but there is no devotion. You are not chanting the holy name. You are not absorbed in Hari Bhajan. What is the use of all this knowledge? It is simply a painstaking endeavor to remember all this. The highest knowledge is bhakti. Only by devotion can you achieve the Supreme Lord. Bhaktya mam abhijanati yavanyashasmi tattvatah. Bhaktistu ananya shakya aham eva vidorjuna. Krishna said this again and again, that it's only by devotional mood. Krishna cannot be caught by our head. Krishna can be caught only by the heart. We have to know enough to perform service to please him. Like, for example, if someone is chanting the holy name, he has already learnt all the essence of all the Shastras. If that knowledge is helping better his devotion, then it is favorable. But if that knowledge is simply some details which is not going to help him in bhakti, it is just going to be head deep and not heart deep. So he told all of this to Nimai. And Nimai said, at the moment I don't have devotion. But with folded palms he said, O Srivasa Thakur, hopefully someday by your blessings I will get there. At the moment I don't have it. But if you pray for me, if you bless me, hopefully someday I will become a devotee. So in this context, it is important to take an example. Like for example, if you take the harmonium or a piano, you know, wherever, any instrument with keys. What is the success? What is the final conclusion of this harmonium? To play songs in it? You know, I'm not, okay, devotion, no doubt, but I'm just taking it as an instrument. To play songs in it? So you learn, all these notes only so that you know how to use them to play a song to find bliss. Correct? This instrument is, if it brings sadness, if it brings unhappiness, then why would you even learn it? It is to bring some joy. That joy will come by playing songs, and that song can be played by learning keys. So the knowledge of the keys ultimately must fructify in giving bliss. If you are so stuck up in which key comes where, that you are playing it so miserably that you are not getting joy out of it, then what is the use of over-knowing all these keys? Understand? Is this clear?
Yes.
So the knowledge of the keys should take us to the point of relishing the instrument. So the knowledge of the Shastras must come to the point of appreciating devotional service, appreciating the glories of the holy name, appreciating Vaishnav Seva, appreciating Vrindavan Dham, appreciating Murti Seva, appreciating Srimad Bhagavatam. So if that appreciation is got by the knowledge, then it is favorable. But if it is so technical and detailed that it is not bringing an appreciation for Krishna, then it is simply a headache. Is this clear? So we are devotees. We are not jnanis. Please repeat. Jnanavalambaka kechit.
Jnanavalambaka
kechit. Kechit karmavalambaka.
Kechit karmavalambaka.
Vayam tu haridasanam.
Vayam tu haridasanam.
Padatranavalambaka.
Padatranavalambaka.
Srila Rupa Goswami in Padyavali, he says, Jnanavalambaka kechit. Some depend on their knowledge. My obeisances to them. Kechit karmavalambaka. Some depend on their own activity. My obeisances to them. Then Rupa Goswami says, but vayam tu, we devotees, hari dasanam padat tranavalambaka. We don't depend on knowledge. We don't depend on our activities. If we depend on something, we depend on the power of the footwear on the lotus feet of pure devotees of Krishna. Vayam tu hari dasanam pada trana. Trana means that which protects. Like mantra. Pada trana. Pada trana means footwear. Pada trana valambaka. If we depend on something, we depend on the footwear of pure devotees. Which means we depend on their mercy. Being at their feet. Like even Krishna is holding the footwear of Nanda Baba. Srila Prabhupada was once approached by one man who said, Swamiji, I can chant 700 verses of the Gita. And not just straight, I can chant 1 to 700 and 700 to 1, back and forth. Prabhupada looked at him and he said, can you even live half a verse? So this is important. We may have all of this here, but how much of that is getting translated in our activities? Devotion means translation. Knowing is one thing and applying that knowledge is another. So when we hear Hari Katha, we should take notes of all these points and then sit and contemplate later. We should be like a ruminating animal. We take all the grass and then sit in one place and chew. The points that we heard in this Hari Katha, how can I get my life to those points? What are practical steps I can take in imbibing those points in my life. Then sitting in that class made sense. Well, anyway, even if you don't practice, heart is getting cleansed by Harikatha. Pravishtya karana randrena swanam bhava saroruham. Bhagavatam describes when you hear about Krishna, even if you don't practice. If you practice, very good. Even if you don't practice, pravishtha karana randrena, it enters through the holes of the ear, and swanam bhava saroruham, and Krishna sits on the lotus of our bhav in the heart. Bhagavatam describes. So that is even if you don't practice. Now, if you practice, it goes even higher. One devotee was saying, if you hear and don't practice, Krishna comes. If you hear and practice, Krishna comes and stays. So therefore, knowing is one and going that way is another. So devotee is he who knows the way, goes the way and shows the way. He knows the way through knowledge, goes the way through practice, and shows the way through preaching. What are the three? Knows the way through Shastra, goes the way through practice, shows the way through preaching. So therefore, the first practical lesson that we can learn from this pastime of Srivasa Thakura is to devote our time more for Krishna. It is devotion which is the highest prominent priority in life. Shripad Ayendra Prabhu used to say, Cheto darpanam arjanam bhavamaha davagni nirvapanam shreyah kairava chandrika vitaranam vidya vadu jivanam, which means vidya, transcendental knowledge, vadu means wife, jivanam. In life, just like a chaste wife follows the husband, similarly, vidya, transcendental knowledge, will come like a chaste wife to someone who chants the holy name. So if you have devotion, transcendental knowledge will come chasing you. But if you just have transcendental knowledge, if it doesn't lead to devotion, it's a headache. Vasudeve bhagavati bhakti yoga prayojitaha janayityasu vairagyam jnanam yaccha ahaitukam. That if there is devotion, she's like the mother who gives birth to two children. One is transcendental knowledge and one is renunciation. Anyone who has bhakti will have knowledge about Krishna and renunciation in this world. But if you just have knowledge, not necessary, you may have bhakti and renunciation. So we must study Shastra so that we know the principles to practice it properly and to share it with others. One devotee was asking this question, that Prabhu, why do we even have to read Shastra then? If Vidyavadu Jivanam, if chanting the holy name can give us everything, then we can just sit and chant and all transcendental knowledge will come. We don't need any Shastra. The point is, it takes time. You cannot just sit and chant Hare Krishna and then all knowledge come immediately. So if we start chanting today and transcendental knowledge rises in the heart 30 years from now to 30, there are so many jivas who will cross through your life. And if they ask you questions and you say, I am waiting for it to be revealed, then you are not facilitating the opening up of their devotion. So we learn from the Shastra so that we can share with them, yet we also depend on devotional service for Divya Gyan Hridaya Prakashita. When devotion is practiced, the heart will open up with knowledge. It is a fact and it is experience for anyone who is performing bhakti. Sometimes there will be things which will be spoken through your tongue by Krishna, which you yourself didn't know. You will say things and then later on you will think, that was a good point. I mean, I didn't know that myself. So how did that happen? Krishna, being happy with some service of devotional practice that we did, opened up a box of mystery from the heart through the lips. And then we start chewing on it because we have not realized it yet. So this is the first point, putting devotion over just collecting information. So this is the first lesson. Now the second story with a lesson related to Srivasa Thakura is that after Jagannath Mishra left his body, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who was Nimai then, he told his mother that I think I should go to Gaya and perform the Shraddha, the last rites, and the different sacrificial offerings for my father's memory. Mother Shachi Mata agreed. Now it was very difficult for her. Jagannath Mishra had left this world. She was depending on Nimai, Vishwambhara. So he went to Gaya to perform the last rites, or let's say the Shraddha. And there he met with his eternal spiritual master, Ishvara Puripada. Now after getting the seed of devotion from Ishvara Puri, when he returned, he was a different personality altogether. He was surcharged with intoxicating devotion. And he made Srivas Thakur's house, Srivas Angan, the headquarters of that explosion. And quite rightly so. His house was very nice. I will tell you in a few minutes how nice his house was. But it was very favorable for devotion. He had big, big banana plantations which would hide in such a way that night time, if they close the doors, no one will know what's happening inside. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he took shelter of this house, and all night they would have loud roaring kirtans. It was not soft meditative kirtans. It was loud kirtans. It was dancing kirtans. This is Gaudiya kirtan. They used to have Gaudiya style kirtan, very, very loud, roaring, screaming, pounding kirtans. So they would do this all night, and people had a big problem with it. Why? Diva charte haya rajan kutumba bharanena va? All day and night people would run around making money for their family, and at night time they want some sleep. And that is the time Nimai Pandit with all his friends would start chanting loudly, very loud. And neighbors would think, someone just throw some rotis into their window. I think they're crying because of hunger. They don't have food. And they're feeling very shy to come and beg. Just throw some rice. Let them be happy. Night, if you don't have food, stomach is growling and that's coming through their mouth. Keep them happy. And they had big problems. They started coming and complaining to Mother Shachi. Something is wrong with your son. When he went to Gaya, he was so good. Charismatic, with so much knowledge. But now that he has come back, he's mad. Something really wrong with your son. Some would come and say, you know, he's haunted by a ghost. In Gaya, we have heard, by performing Shraddha, there are so many ghosts. And one of those ghosts have entered your son. So what you do is, you take some ghee, offer it to Lord Shiva and give him regularly. So because of the power of that prasad from Lord Shiva, the ghost will run away. Another person came to Shachi Mata and said, even that will not work on your son. It's gone beyond a certain limit. That ghee will work till a certain point, but your son has crossed all thresholds. So now for him, you need Vishnu oil. You have to massage his forehead properly and pray. Only that will work. Narayanja? The third person came and said, what you should do is, you should offer some coconut water and give it to him. That will cool his body. I think because of too much heat, it's exploding. Fourth person came and told Mother Shachi, just tie him up after sunset. You know, he's very risky. Not just for him, it's risky for us, no doubt. It's also risky for him, because what he does to us, if we start taking revenge, it will be risky for him. So better protect us and protect him by tying him up. So Mother Shachi, poor lady, she was thinking, I have lost my husband Jagannath Mishra. I have lost my older son Vishwarup to sannyas. I have one son now who has gone mad. I have no help. So she went to this Srivas Thakur, who was like the uncle, and said, you know, what is wrong with my child? You really think he's mad? Everyone is saying my son has gone crazy. He's gone insane. You know him and you know Shastra. You tell me, I am a simple lady. I don't understand all this. You please tell me, has my son got mad? Srivas Thakur smiled and he said, I wish everyone goes mad like this. Oh mother, please note this disease that has caught him, this fever that has caught him, this ghost who has caught him, and this madness which has caught him. It's actually something that we all should be caught by. This ghost is the ghost of devotion. He has prema. And I wish even I had it. So Srivasa Thakura actually pacified Shachi Mata and said that your son is not mad. He is having pure devotion for Krishna. And because of which people who don't understand this, they think he's mad. He told Mother Shachi, the greatest hankering in this world is to hanker for love of Godhead. And when love of Godhead comes in our life, these are the symptoms. One goes completely insane and one can't be understood in society. Please repeat. Our King Kulashekhar Alwar says in Mukundamala Stotra, Tyajantu Bandhava Sarve,
Tyajantu Bandhava Sarve,
Nindantu Guravo Jana,
Nindantu Guravo Jana,
Tathapi Paramanandam,
Tathapi Paramanandam,
Govindo Mama Jeevanam,
Govindo Mama Jeevanam.
Kulashekhar says, Tyajantu Bandhava Sarve, seeing my devotion for Sri Hari, let all my friends leave me. No problem. Tyajantu. And Nindantu Guravo Jana, let all my seniors and superiors criticize me. No problem. Tathapi Paramanandam Govinda Mama Jeevanam. Still the greatest source of happiness, Sri Hari, is my life and soul. You see, this is a common trait. Anyone who has devotion for Sri Hari will be ridiculed. Because people in general are mad behind Maya. They are mad behind pleasures of this world, the skin. For those who are mad, the pleasure of the soul, incompatible. As Srila Prabhupada would say, they think we are crazy and we think they are crazy. But the difference is, we are right and they are wrong. Srila Prabhupada also had this desire, I wish I had devotion. Those who have it think they don't have it. And those who don't have it don't desire for it. And devotees are in the middle. They want it, but they don't have it. Srila Prabhupada writes in one of the purports of Srimad Bhagavatam, especially in the section of Dhruva Maharaj. You see where Dhruva Maharaj became a pure devotee and he was going back home, back to Godhead. And his mother got a complimentary seat because she was the Pat Pradarshak Guru. She didn't practice bhakti, but she told you practice bhakti. See, my spiritual master sometimes says, in bhakti, we are so selfless. Main bhakti karo na karo, tum avashya karo. He was saying when he was brahmachari, one brahmachari was known for this. He would wake up all the other brahmacharis and then go to sleep. He would never be found for Mangalarti, but all other brahmacharis would say, if he was not there, yadi brahmachari na hoi to, tave ki hoi to. Hey, Mangalarti bahita kishe. You know, how will we spend this Mangalarti without him? You know? So my spiritual master says, he's so selfless. Khud maya mein soenge par tum jago. So Prabhupada says in that mother, Dhruva Maharaj's mother got some commission because her son to whom she preached became a pure devotee. Prabhupada writes in that purport, in this mood I am preaching. If one of my disciples becomes liberated like Dhruva Maharaj, then I have some chance he will take me also. Just like Dhruva Maharaj took his mother. So this is the point. So the second lesson that we can learn from this story is that we should have deep desire to become mad for Krishna. Either we have to be mad in this world or we have to become mad for Krishna, and the second is better. You've taken so many lifetimes being mad in this world. Nunam pramatta kurute vikarma. Pramatta. The madness of this world has no end. But the madness for Krishna, devotion, it culminates in getting him. So those who want Krishna, Krishna gives himself to them. Even Madhavendra Puri had the same desire to get him. Please repeat.
Ai deen dayardhra nath hai.
Ai deen
Mathura Nath Kadavalokyase.
Mathura Nath Kadavalokyase.
Hridayam Twad Aloka Kataram.
Hridayam Twad Aloka Kataram.
Daita Brahmyati Kim Karomyaham.
Daita Brahmyati Kim Karomyaham.
Madhavendra Puri chanted this verse and left this world. The last verse he chanted. And what was it? Ai Deena Dayardhra Natha Hai. O Supreme Lord, O He who's compassionate on those who don't have bhakti. Mathura Nath, O Lord of Mathura, Kada Avalokya Se, when can I see you? Ridayam Twad Aloka Kataram, my heart is palpitating at double speed to see you. Daita, O beloved, Brahmyati Kim Karomyaham, I am disturbed, what can I do without you? So, desiring to get Krishna is the price to get him. Krishna Bhakti Rasa Bhavita Mati. Kiyatam yadi kutopi labhyate tatra laulyam ekam mulyam koti janma sukritirna labhyate. So the first lesson from the story is devotion. Second is desire. Desiring to get Krishna. Third story with Srivasa Thakur. When Srivasa Thakur was facilitating these kirtans at night, people in general hated him. The envious didn't like him because this was very closed. Not all of them could have entry into it. Very, very confidential. So those who were Hindu Brahmanas, they would say, Srivas, you are facilitating kirtans in your house. And during Chaturmas, you're doing this kirtan. During Chaturmas, Vishnu sleeps. And you're facilitating these kirtans all night. Vishnu will wake up, and when he wakes up in disturbed sleep, he will be angry and then he'll curse us. So the Brahmanas were thinking that Vishnu behaves the way they do when they are disturbed from sleep. You see, when we are sleeping and someone wakes us up, like Muchukunda Maharaj, we burn them through our glands. You see? By the way, Muchukunda Maharaj is a very wonderful inspiration for all the devotees. Sone bhi mila aur Bhagwan bhi mile. So he got to sleep also. He slept the whole of Satya, Treta and Dwapar. And when he woke up, he saw Krishna. This is wonderful. No bhakti, no chanting, no hearing. Just sleep for three yugas and then Krishna wakes you up. But not all of us can be Muchukunda. So we are like that when we are disturbed. Tava karakamala varena kamadhuta shingam. We'll tear him apart. They thought even Vishnu behaves like that. So they said, why are you waking him up? This is Chaturmas. Hare Krishna, soft, soft, not so loud. So he would say, when you chant loudly, everyone gets the benefit. He said, hey Baba, we don't want the benefit. You don't wake Vishnu up. So Brahmanas had a problem. People in general had a problem because they didn't have entry into it. They were very suspicious. Kya andar ho kya raha hai? They're all howling and crying and screaming. Maybe there is hardcore intoxication going on inside. They are drinking, and in that intoxication, they are screaming and they are putting a show of devotion. So the Srivas is facilitating all this. So people in general had a problem. Brahmanas had a problem. And Muslims anyway had a problem. They anyway had a problem. So they started sending rumors. It is described, they told Srivas that we have told Nawab. And he's sending his soldiers to come and kill you. Because you're not abiding by our principles. Srivas went inside the house. And he was worshipping a Narsingha Shaligram Shila. Srivas Thakur had a Narsingha Shaligram. So he was worshipping this Narsingha Shaligram Shila. And he was crying desperately. Desperately he was crying, Narasingadev, please help me, Narasingadev, please help me, Narasingadev, please help me. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, in the mood of a cowherd boy, was strolling on the banks of the Ganga. And at that time, he heard that the Srivas Thakur is calling for him. So in the mood of Narasingadev, he developed 8 more arms with conch shell and disc and all of this, and he went running. And he was knocking the door of Srivas, and Srivas was shivering, thinking that these are the soldiers of the king. And he said, I didn't do anything, I didn't do anything. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was saying, open the door. And Srivas wouldn't open the door. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, the person whom you're secretly praying for protection is waiting outside your door to protect you. Open the door. And Srivas had no clue. Now, Narasingadeva outside? Who would open the door if you know Narasingadeva is ringing the bell? And Ugra Narasingha. It's not even Shanta Narasingha. You may probably open the door and hide behind so that the next person gets the mercy. So he wasn't opening the door. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu kicked the door open. And he looked at Srivas. And Srivas was shivering. Now Mahaprabhu was like 8 feet tall. And his hands raised. And he told Srivas, I am Narasimha. One day before, Mahaprabhu had told Srivas, Jivas cannot be God. Now Srivas starts thinking. Mayavada bhashya shunila hoila sarvanas. Yesterday he told me that we cannot become God, and today he's proclaiming himself to be God. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, come and fall at my lotus feet, I will protect you. Srivas is thinking, something is seriously wrong. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu invoked the Narasingha potency in him. And he invoked all the different weapons, and with the face of a lion he was roaring. He appeared as Narasingadev. He appeared red in complexion. Srivas Thakur saw Narasingadev and he bowed down, took protection from Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's lotus feet. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, the same Narasingadev has appeared as Shachinandan Gaurahari. You take shelter of my lotus feet and I will protect you. Call all your family members. Srivas got scared now. No gastrointestinal operations here. So when all the family came, very large family, 4 or 5 brothers, and all of them have children, and all of them stayed together. It's a joint family. All called in. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu with his innumerable hands touched their lotus head and gave them prema. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu protected like Narasingha and bestowed blessings like Chaitanya. Narasingadev protects. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gives prema. Both of this in one incarnation found as Chaitanya. When you pray to Narasimhadev, he will protect you, but he cannot give you love of Godhead. But when you pray to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he can protect you like Narasimha and bless you with love of Godhead. So the third lesson here is, when we pray, let's pray to Chaitanya, who has appeared as Narasimha, Gaur Narasimha. And the third D is desperate praying. We must learn to pray like Srivas did. He was a householder and he had problems, and he took those problems to Narasimhadev out of desperation. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was on the banks of the Ganga, but just by his fervent calling, he came and he blessed him. So even if we as Grihasthas take our problems to our deity and desperately pray like he did, Krishna, who's strolling on the banks of Yamuna, will kick open our door to protect us. So the first story taught us devotion. Second story taught us desire. Third story teaches us desperation, to pray with desperation. Now is the fourth story. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu very confidentially asked Srivas one day. He said, I have never seen you work. You have such a big family. Where do you get all the money from? I have never seen you do any work. You never leave the house. It's not even work from home, because I don't see any laptop. You don't log in as soon as it's 8:30 in the morning. Log in on one side and then talk, and then again just go and move the mouse. I've never seen you do this. You don't have any business. I've never seen you beg. How do you get all your money from? And Srivas Thakur explains, my lord, I don't work because I have no desire to work. Wish we all could say that. Man nahi lagta. Ghar wale bolenge, to kya hua, phir bhi jao. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, okay, you have no inspiration and desire to do, but you have a big family. How do you maintain them? So Srivas Thakur said, it's all about destiny, my lord. If it's written in your destiny, you will get it even without work. And if it's not written in your destiny, even after working, you will not get it. So what is written will come. My Lord, just like we never pray for cough and cold and fever and flu, you still get it. Similarly, happiness will also come your way. Distress, you don't pray for it, it finds you. Happiness will also find you. You don't have to do anything. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu sarcastically remarked, so you're like a sannyasi. You're very detached. Do something. Give up family life, take sannyas and move with me. He himself is grihastha, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. But he's preparing. Shiva said, no, sannyas is not for me. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, so you're not begging. You're not working. You don't have a business. You have no savings, no plan. How do you do this? Such a big family. To which Shiva said, my Lord, all that I do is I chant. I chant continuously. And I just clap. 3 times. Which means I wait for 3 days. If I have any desire, I chant continuously for 3 days. And 1, 2, 3. I wait for 3 days. If in those 3 days I don't get it, I don't need it. If I want it and I get it, wonderful, Krishna's arranging. Very simple. If I have a desire, I chant for 3 days and I just wait. If I don't get it, wonderful, I don't need it. But if I get it, Krishna's arranging. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, what would you do for food? Shiva said, I will chant and wait 3 days. If I get no food, I will jump into the Ganga and commit suicide. Very simple. But interestingly, I always get it. I have to put like a disclaimer here like they put for the WWE. Please don't try this at home. So Srivas could do it and his wife didn't have a problem. Srivas was so dedicated. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told Srivas, I have to tell you something, Srivas. Your devotion is so deep. You depend so much on Sri Krishna that it's possible that Lakshmi one day may go begging in poverty from door to door, but there will be no lack in your house. You will have no poverty. And I have personally seen this in my life. As I was saying, another family the other day, one Mataji in Mumbai, she was living in a hut, in a chawl. She didn't have money. And she heard that if you chant the holy name, all the goddesses of Lakshmi will come and reside in your house because you're calling out to Narayan and Narayan never comes alone. So it's a very planned process. So she started chanting 64 rounds of japa every day. Mother of two. It's interesting. She started then living in a rented 1 BHK. Then she purchased a 1 BHK. Then she started living in a 2 BHK. Now has two homes. One in which she stays and another she has put on rent. And her faith is so high, she's chanting all day. All day. She works as a school teacher. Makes some money out of it. She says, this is just to show Krishna that I can also do something. But actually I know it's my japa which is making more money than my school teacher business. She says, as a teacher, I'm working for 6 hours. I'm getting less pay than what I'm getting by chanting the holy name. And there are so many devotees like that. By chanting, by increasing your chanting, even the money intake has gone higher. Like as I was saying, Ramananda Rai's brother Gopinath Patnaik, by chanting the holy name of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, his salary was tripled. So it's wonderful. So therefore, the fourth D that we can have is dependence on Sri Krishna. It's good to do our duty. We do our best and to Krishna we leave the rest for him to do the best. It's not our own endeavor which makes it. And it's not just Krishna's grace which makes it. We have to have both. For a practical reality that we are living in, we have to work as if it depends on us and pray as if it is Krishna's mercy. So due to lack of time, we'll skip the fifth story and we'll just have four. So with the first story we learned, to know, have knowledge as much as it takes us to devotion and to hear more to nourish our devotion. That's the D, first D, devotion. The second story we heard is to desire genuinely to have Krishna in one's life. Not that we want to be a half-baked cookie in our spiritual life. We want to give completely, really desire so that we deserve. Third story. When we pray to Krishna, it shouldn't again be half-hearted. We pray desperately like Srivas did. And fourth, we live in this world, but not of this world. We work hard, but we ultimately understand it all depends on the mercy of Sri Hari. If he says a no, it's not going to happen. And if he says a yes, even if I don't, like Rajinikanth, I'll get a PhD in my house. Rajinikanth was given honorary PhD sitting home. He can practically say like Srivas Pandit, Naseeb mein likha hoga to ghar pe baith ke bhi PhD aata. But since we are not Rajinikanth, Gopal Chandra Prabhu is not here. Why the snowstorm in Minnesota? Okay. So anyway, so we are not Rajinikanths, we will not get PhD at home. So we have to work, but at the same time depend on the mercy of Sri Hari. So devotion to Krishna, desire to get Krishna, desperately pray to Krishna and depend on Krishna as the four D's from the stories of Srivasa Thakura. Srivasa Thakura Mahashayaki.
Jai. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.